I said, we postpone the results and I postpone the debrief. We'll come up to that later this afternoon. I now want to give you some insight in the fundamentals of incident response. This picture should be known already. We have on the left-hand side threats. Threats are against our assets. Why? Because assets bear vulnerabilities, and if you don't have the right countermeasures in place, then the threat agent is able to perform a threat using the vulnerability on your asset. So what I did was, on the left hand side, the threats and threat agents are red, the assets and the vulnerabilities are blue. So we have red versus blue, and they will encounter each other in the middle. And like Sun Tzu said, you not only need to know yourself, but mainly need to know your enemy. Okay, we start with knowing ourselves. We know we have assets as an organization, and they bear vulnerabilities in themselves. We know the main goal of security is to protect our valuable assets. And some of the things that we have to protect when we talk about information security are our data and services, because we don't want any loss of CIA, confidentiality, integrity and availability. So what we need to do is protecting our assets by building around our assets. Here is the asset in right in the middle. A lot of layers of defense, lines of defense, so that if you want to go to the piece of gold that's somewhere in the middle, you have to, as an attacker, dig yourselves through a lot of lines of defense, a lot of layers. Each layer makes it more difficult for an attacker to perform a threat, and each layer that you add around your asset will help as a countermeasure against malicious acts. If you look into what do these layers do, these lines of defense, well, they help you to protect your CIA by using people, process and technology. And you have different types of countermeasures or controls: preventive, detective, responsive and corrective. So you have to think about what are you putting in which layer to prevent somebody from attacking you. And if somebody is attacking you, you have to put into your layers something of detection, that you know somebody is trying to attack you. And if somebody really is skilled and knows how to go through your preventive and detective layers of defense, then you should be able, while the attack is going on, to react, to get it on hold, to stop it. And if you're too late, then the attacker went through all lines of defense. The only thing you can do is repair the damage, to correct what was used or misused by the attacker. So if you are in the blue mindset, you have to think about which layers, which lines of defense are we going to build, and in which layer are we going to use preventive, detective, responsive and corrective controls. On the other hand, our attackers, the threats and the threat agents, think about sneaky ways to get past your lines of defense, and they make use of certain blind spots, vulnerabilities that are known but not solved, to get into your organization and to get hold of the little lumps of gold. But remember, the threats are not only man-made. There can be an act of act of nature or act of God. And there can also be a failure or an error. Because you always have to think that Murphy can attack. If not today, then tomorrow, maybe next week. So if you look into the rat mindset, you have to think about a lot of stuff as attacker that you are going to use. It depends on what kind of attacker you are, what tools you are going to use, which vulnerabilities you are going to use to get in, what actions you take, what your target is, what the result is that you want to get hold of, or what is the result of your attack, and finally, what's your ultimate goal as an attacker? What do you want to get? Power, money, weapons, whatever your motive might be. And you see that just like the defense part, the blue part, the red part, is also built up on layers. A lot of preparation, then where you are going to perform the attack, and then the actual attacking, the aftermath. So the moment the two parties meet, there has been a lot of work done on the agent side, but also there has been a lot of work done on the defender side. And it depends on how good the preparation is on the red side and how good the preparation is on the blue side, which party attacking or defending will succeed. This is where they come together. If you have a threat, when it's realized, then you have an attack. An attack will always try to find and exploit a vulnerability. And if the attack can use the vulnerability in a positive way, we have a certain impact. Impact on the business or loss or whatever. But the blue ones have preventive, detective, deterrent, corrective controls in place. So you hope as blue team that at any point in time where an attacker is doing something, that you are able to withhold the attacker. And hopefully at the end, prevent the attacker from getting his hands on the gold. So when the two meet, we have a battle. But first we have to decide, this battle is an event. But is this event really an incident? And if so, is it a security incident? So we have to, as blue party, decide, is here a security incident at hand? Now you have to make a distinction between a security event and a security incident. A security event, you see, is something that is happening, has been triggered, or is going on, and it has a possible breach. You don't know for certain yet, because it's only an event. You are monitoring and you're detecting, hey, something is happening. Could be bad, could be planned. Good. So first thing if you discover an event is going on, you have to be aware of the fact that not every event is a possible breach of security. It can also be a failure. It can also be something that is happening on your network or on your computer systems that never happened before. Something unknown. So the first thing you have to do is try to figure out if a specific event really is a security incident. That's what we call triage. And we want to know, there is something happening, is it shit or isn't it? And if it's shit, then we have to react in the way incident response wants us to do. So when an event seems to be a security incident, then you know by analyzing the event that it's something that you not wanted, that something that you didn't expect, and it has a significant probability that you get some kind of loss. Loss of CIA, loss of reputation, loss of people, loss of property, whatever. Okay, so you are thinking first event, okay, is it incident, yes or no? Yes, it's incident. Aha, we have a security incident. The next step you are going to do, can we decide in which category this specific security incident belongs? It depends on if it's an accident or if there is some party, a threat agent, that deliberately causing this incident. And it can also be that it's not a human cause, but it has a cause somewhere in the technical infrastructure or the equipment or whatever. It can be the building. So what we need to do is event. Okay, security incident. We have four categories where we can streamline what we are going to do with incident response. The first thing is unauthorized usage. Somebody is not allowed to use the asset or the assets. Denial of service, you can't use anything anymore because somebody shut down the system. Somebody implemented an application or a piece of software that was not yours but is strange and it's even malicious. And it can also be that most of the time an insider made inappropriate use of your systems. Before I go on, I saw a hand going up. Question.
Yeah, what if since a security incident is a series of security events, is it possible that a security incident can be listed of multiple errors? Why it works?
Yes, so you are, if you are in a good blue mindset, you're continuously monitoring what's in your systems, what's going on. And during that monitoring, you discover, hey, something is happening. We call it an event. The next step, if something is happening, an event, you need to know, is this bad or is this acceptable? If it's bad, then it's a security incident, and then you know a security incident is only, you can say, a general noun for something. The incident itself can be subdivided in one or more steps, security events. We'll come back to that when we do a real triage later on in this course. So now we have event, yes or no, incident, yes incident, okay, is it unauthorized usage, is it denial of service, is it malicious code, or is it inappropriate usage? Yes, and we are going to be confronted by the assignments you are going to do by at least 3 out of 4 of these categories. Most of the time, if it's unauthorized usage, depending on if you have help of an insider, it could be a case of inappropriate usage too.
Okay.
We are going to look into denial of service, and we are going to look into malicious code. So that will be in the upcoming assignments. So, event, security incident, yes or no? If yes, then 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh. So that brings us to the overarching name, incident management. You hear a lot of names. You hear incident management, incident response, incident handling. What is what? Well, like every management, it's something for the sea level. But we know, if we are looking into what we need, the ISO 27002, we are going to deal with incident management, clause 13, and later on clause 14, business continuity. So this incident management consists of a couple of activities. But, like I said, event, incident, which of the four categories, you can also take the broader picture and say, okay, if we are talking about incidents on the blue side, the sea level, based on the results of a risk assessment, has put in place incident management. That's a process, that's a management process. And every management process has always the same cycle. You plan something, you do something, you act something after you have checked it. The PDCA cycle. It's an ongoing cycle. It's not a one-way action. So the incident management is a process of how to manage an incident. So first you plan how to do it, then you do it, then you check how did you do it, and finally you could act or repair or rebuild your incident management process. Part of the incident management as a process is the actual responding to an incident. That's what we call incident response. That's a practice. That's a set of activities. So what you do in incident response is detecting a problem. And a problem is an event that seems to be an incident. If you have an incident, you have to determine where does the incident come from, the cause. We have four causes now, root causes. We have to take care that we minimize the damage, as less damage as possible. That's what we want. And of course we want to resolve the problem. We want to get rid of that what caused the security incident, and if the security incident was a threat that made use of a specific vulnerability, we have to plug the hole of that vulnerability, repair it, so that that type of security incident using that specific vulnerability is no longer possible. And of course you have to document. You have to write down everything that you do from the moment that you are made aware that there is an incident from until the moment that you have resolved it and that you can document all the steps you took. Within incident management as a process, so you have the practices, the activities of incident response, and within incident response you have one specific set of activities. That's what we call the incident handling. That's containing and repairing the damage. So freeze the scene. So you see this triangle, it's broad incident management, then smaller incident response, and the smallest part is incident handling. If you see the official description of incident management in the ISO 27002. You see one, plan and prepare, two, identify, three, four, five, react, manage and contain and resolve, and six, learned. So what I did is one until six is incident management. Within incident management is two until five, incident response. And within incident response is manage and contain incident handling. And if you talk about incident response, you have to be aware of the context, what you are going to do. So we are not dealing with incident management, we are mainly dealing with incident response, so identification, reaction, manage and containing, and resolving. And of course, documenting. Oops. Okay. I only had a blue picture available, but you can imagine that the left-hand side could be a red picture. But it's a mix. So a threat is coming up, the red arrow. The question is, are you prepared to respond to a security breach? So that's an event that turns out to be a security incident. If so, if you are prepared, then you should have in place the process of incident management. Within that process, the practice of incident response, and within in incident response, the specific activity of handling the incident. You can see what I put next to the triangle. Incident management is from start to the end of a security breach. By incident response, we are freezing the scene. It's like when a crime happens, you put up the yellow tape, crime scene, and then you have to do all the stuff that you need to do at the scene. And the main thing is first damage control. Be aware that nothing gets contaminated with influences out of on the outer boundaries of the scene. And then after you control the damage, then you can investigate what happened at the scene. And then afterwards you can finish up all the way down. We are not going to do incident investigation, because that's more in the line of forensic intelligence and security. And the whole part-time minor starting in September next is on incident investigation. So, the context. As an organization with a blue mindset, you need to prepare. First you did a risk assessment. Well, the SEC students did that last period. Based on the results of the risk assessment, you develop a security architecture and you have to have a response plan available. Then, events are happening and somebody is going to give you a message about an ongoing event. And you have to sift through the events. Is there among these events a security incident? If so, you have detected a security incident. Then you go on to triage. You have to find out what type of security incident you have. Then you can give the right response to that security incident. And of course, if you are real blue, then you have a lot of protection measures, protective controls in place. Take a look at what maybe it can help you when you are performing assignment number two. It's only a clue. Okay, when you do incident response, the practice, you commonly see four stages: preparation, detection and analysis, containment, eradication and recovery, and post-incident activity. It's all over the world a common model for incident response, and there is one organization that has written a lot about standards and how to do what phase. I write down it's the National Institute for Security and Technology. It's an American institute, so it's the American way, but they prepared a lot of standards and practices that are used all over the world, also in Europe, also in the Netherlands. So if you are looking for overt sources, take advantage of the documents of NIST. Okay, you can see it in different ways. Circular, that if you are in one activity and you come to the conclusion that it's not enough, then you can go back. You see it also as an ongoing set, start here, then there, and then it's a loop back. It's a life cycle. Okay. When you are thinking about, hey, I'm creating an event, hey, it could be a security incident, hey, somebody has to respond, you have to be aware, as a red teamer, that the blue team will have some kind of preparation. So an organization has something in place, besides of the lines of defense, to make it more difficult for a red teamer to achieve what he wants to achieve. So the main thing in a preparation when you talk about incident response is that you have an incident response team. You see it in many ways, in many under many names. You see it as ICERT, as CERT, CIRT, Computer Incident Response Team, Computer Emergency Response Team. So you have to have a team ready that if shit happens, immediately can come into action. And of course, if you have a CERT, a Computer Incident Response Team, they need to have the tools and the equipment to respond in a proper way. It's like the fire brigade. You always have the fire brigade ready, and only when a fire alarm reaches the fire brigade, it comes into action. Then you have the sirens, the red cars crossing through the streets, and then rolling out the material, starting to pull water, and hopefully get rid of the fire. But the fire brigade has to prepare. They have to train, they have to exercise, so that they know when a real fire happens, what to do. Okay, you always should have a prepared incident response team ready. And then, hey, something happens, event, hey, it's a security incident. Then you need to be able to detect a security incident, and you have to be able to analyze what's the type. And also you have to see there can be something happening towards a specific asset, but it's also possible that the attack that is going on is not only meant specifically for one asset, but it could also have causes for other assets. And it could escalate. It starts small, but it grows bigger and bigger and bigger until you have a catastrophe. So it's part of the detection and analysis stage of an incident response team to establish, is this containable or is it going to evolve into a big disaster? Then you come to the next stage, that's the actual incident handling. containment, eradication, and recovery. You need to isolate the security incident that's going on. You need to isolate and prevent the spreading of the causes of the security incident throughout your whole organization or your system. It could be that you need to take several measures to stop the incident. In the worst case, it could be shutting down all your production systems and then get a mess out of your systems and then restart your production systems until it can be live. Then you have to know how to stop a system in a safe way, how to restart a system, how to make use of your backups. Backups? Oops, we forgot to make backups. It's a common problem in organizations that when something goes wrong, you come to the conclusion we don't have backups, or we have backups, but only from 2 days ago, not from a week ago. Or we have backups, but they can't be read into the system, so we can't restart the system. I wish it was a joke, but it's a common problem that you come across when an incident happens, that backups don't do what they are meant to do. So then your recovery could be a problem. Finally, you close the incident with post-incident activities. You write a report, you document everything that you have, especially the holes you have plugged and with what you plug the holes. And as I mentioned, it all starts with shit happens. Hopefully you are good, prepared, and then you can, here you have the clash between red and blue, and the blue ones need to do this whole all way, or if you like this way, like a waterfall. These are the steps you need to take. And like I mentioned, only incident handling is containment, eradication, and recovery. So that's only containment and recovery. So those three are incident handling, and all five are incident response plus preparation and the aftermath. Okay. How about break?
You?
Okay. 15 minutes break. 10, 2, 3. We start again. Oké, ben je vis of?
Nee, sec.
Nee, en jij bent?
Max Kooijman, ik had er nog een uur.
Oké, dan heb ik heb nog een team.
Yeah.
Die hebben nog mensen nodig.
Mm-hmm.
Dus dan ga ik jou hier vast bijzetten.
Ja,
dan ga ik het straks even aankondigen.
Ja, dank u wel.
Want ik heb 3 vissers en dan moeten er nog 2 sekkers bij. Dus jij bent de eerste van de die erbij komt. Ik ga straks aankondigen dat je in 15 zit.
Ja. Ja.
Zeg je? Dankjewel. Yeah. ladies and gentlemen, let's continue. So we talked about the broad process of incident management. Within incident management, we have the practice of incident response, and part of incident response is incident handling. We'll take a closer look at those three components that interact during the course, but for today you know enough about that type of fundamental. Like I said, event. Yes, no, security incident. If yes, security incident, then which category? If you know that it really is a security incident and it's either in unauthorized usage or inappropriate usage of or a kind of denial of service or malicious code, then you have to do your analysis as one step in incident response. When you have a security incident, there was a question out of the classroom earlier. If you look into a security incident, it can be one single event, but it can also be more events. One event causing, triggering another event. So what you need to do is go back to, if it's like a tree, go back. You see the leaves, go back through the branches, to the root. What's the main cause, or what's the root cause, as we call it, of that specific incident? And of course you have to look in other assets related than only the asset that is under attack, but we'll talk about that next time. We need to know, to figure out, what is the root cause. And mainly, we have five typical root cause categories. You see them over here. It's either a human error, or it's a failure from your hardware or your software or a combination. It can be a natural disaster, an act of nature. It can be a malicious attack, and it can be a failure from another party you're doing business with, or another party that has something to do with your systems. Could be your the one who supplies your cloud services, or your ISP, or whatever. So the first thing we have to know is, if you have these five categories of root causes, what falls under each root cause? Human error. Well, the name is obvious. There is some person of flesh and blood that did something wrong. Most of the time not willfully. It's simply a slip of mind. So a human error is most frequently an inside error. So if you come across a security incident, you have to decide, it was inappropriate usage, then most of the time it's a human error, thank God, and not a malicious attack. So what's a human error? Lots of times you see that the people who are in charge with the IT systems did something wrong. Okay, they installed a router, but they didn't configure the router the right way. Meaning, they created one or more vulnerabilities. It could also be that the IT operations people need to make backups on schedule, and something went wrong with making the backups. They didn't notice it, so we have incorrect backups. So that's a type of mis activity. Or if you have a large database and you have to split up the database in several single databases, it is usually a problem to do that right, and then you have a misconfiguration and then your database is corrupted. It can also be a human error because of erroneous use or application of procedures. You have to log on, and if you log on, you have to use a password, and you have the standard, the default password setting. Or what you do is the famous post-it next to your screen with your password on it. Oh, it's underneath the keyboard. That's not the procedure. You should keep your password secret, blah, 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 blah. Nice. But people are the weakest link in security. So it can be that a human error is the root cause of a security incident because of an application of a procedure that didn't work out. Well, the second root cause, hardware software failure, well, it says what it means. It's your own fault as organization or as administrator that the hardware breaks down or doesn't do what it should do, or that the software collapses due to bad testing by the software engineers, or they patched a bug in the software and they didn't test the correlation of that fixed bug with the rest of the application, and then it takes your system down or takes your whole network down or whatever. So human software failure is quite a common cause for security incidents. Hopefully after you have had the course on software security, you make less software failures, and because you already both FISSES and SECRES had infrastructure security, hopefully you know what to do to prevent hardware failures. Well, the thing you have the least influence on is the category third-party external party failures. That can be a human type of error. That can be a procedure that has been agreed upon but not lived after. That can be problems in the company that's supplying you with whatever things, or that is distributing your products. So these are not malicious. They have a problem because they are root causes of security incidents, but the two that are coming up are much more nastier. Natural disaster or acts of nature. Well, that's due to severe weather conditions, depending on where your company resides, you have more or less trouble. You can prepare for natural disasters, but not at any cost. Then we have the most wicked category. If you have an event and it turns out to be a security incident, and it turns out to be unauthorized usage, or malicious code, or denial of service, then you certainly know it's a root cause malicious attack. This is what the red teamers plan to do, malicious attacks. Well, a malicious attack can be caused by a person, or group of persons, but it can also be caused by something persons made, for example, an application or piece of hardware. When we look into malicious attacks, we have two types. The physical security attacks, then you have unauthorized usage, but then unauthorized physical access to something, mainly buildings. That's what you did in assignment one. And the second one is more a list of examples, is a logical security attack. Then you have an unauthorized usage, but it's on unauthorized logical access. You see a lot of examples. So everything that's on this list and the three under physical security attacks that you should be able to cope with as an organization. Your first assignment you did as teams was a malicious attack simulating a physical security attack, namely unauthorized physical access to the building of this software sales company. Your next assignment will be a logical security attack. So you are trying to get unauthorized logical access to the systems of a company. And the following assignments will be on denial of service and malicious code. So, I have to, I'll tell you the brief for assignment two, and then I think I have to ask help from the white team, because the computer, like it's configured at the moment, won't allow me to get to the network. So I can't get hold of your...
That problem is persistent all morning for every student online.
Okay. Is the system down?
Yes.
From this building? Okay, but because this morning at home I could easily log in and get on the network, and there was no problem at all, because I saw at 11 o'clock that there were 14 documents uploaded onto the VLO. But now he says, "Tui, I'll try it again later, otherwise we'll get other arrangements." Okay, assignment two. Before I go to assignment two, I have a team 15. Yes. And team 15 consists of three SEC students, Isa Klop, Max Koyman, Sylvain Ullier, and three FIS students, Niels Masdorp, Lars Legheid, and Daan Roet. And I have already two members of a team 16. Two FIS students, Jeff Huismans and Milko Major. So I need at least one FIS student and three security students to complete team number 16. Who's not in the team yet? Two people. Your name?
Rashad
Basarat Sek.
Yes.
Okay. Vis? Okay, who's here? Sec. I know the faces of the Sec students. Okay. So I have, I need one security student. Is there one single SEC or FIS student that hasn't joined the team yet? Don't be shy. It's not possible because I need to have 18 teams, so there are a lot of students missing. Okay, for the moment, we have a team 16 with 5 students. Chef Huismans Vis, Milko Major Vis, Ruud Rijmering Vis, Rashad Bazarat Security and Jeroen Hogedoorn Security. We need a 6th member. But now we have a team 15 and 16, so you are joining in. Okay, assignment number 2. Oh. Of course you get a brief. The brief. Okay. It's set up the same way as last time, but you know, upcoming Monday is King's Day. Yes, so it's a day off. Ah, it's a free Monday for all of us. So remember, you only have a 4 days week next week, and then we have our May holiday week. And I don't want you to work for school during your May holiday. That's why I put your deadline. Look closely, on Friday, the 1st of May, that's the Friday before the May holiday, before 12 o'clock in the evening. Yes? So if I put it on the Monday after the May holiday, you could forget that you had to deliver something. So that's why I put your deadline on Friday next week, so you have almost 2 weeks to work on it. Well, 1.5. Okay. Okay. The assignment number 2 is as follows. You can use the scenario of assignment 1. You can use the assigned target from scenario 1, so nothing new. The only thing that's new is the job you've got to do. Okay, what do you have to do? The red teams, this is written for you. And the even numbers, the even team numbers, are now, at this assignment number 2, the red teams. So the even team numbers are doing the attack. I'll tell in a way, in a moment, what the blue teams are going to do. Okay. Your first job was to probe the physical security. How do you get unauthorized physical access to the building? Your second job as red teamer is going to be the logical security attack. So you have to attack the logical security of the company, meaning the computer security. It's the same way, black bag job. So sneak in, do what you have to do, get out without being detected. And sneaking in means, in assignment number 2, virtually sneaking in. You don't have to get access to the building, no. You need to get access to the network, over the network, to find the specific proprietary information a competitor could get hold of. Okay. The computer systems and the network system of this a software company in the sales department is a Windows-based network. Keep that in mind. As red teamer, you step into the mindset of an intruder, and your interest is covertly stealth under the radar, covertly stealing the specific type of information. So don't think about getting into the building, to the fourth floor, into an office, into a computer, and then steal the information. No, you're at distance and you have to virtually break in. So try to find out a way to break, logically break into the network, into the computer system, to get hold of this electronically stored type of information. So what you're going to do is you are creating an event. Yes. You are creating a security incident. Yes. And it's unauthorized usage. You're not allowed formally to get to that data. So you have to think as red teamers, how do I gain logical access to the data? And then you have to think about, okay, this beautiful piece of gold I'm looking for is of course behind a lot of lines of defense that the blue teamers will put up. Which lines do I have to cross or go through before I get my hands on the gold? Okay. Step through how you might plan and execute not a physical black job but a logical black job against this our client. Use the phases of attacking. I'll explain those phases in a moment because that's in part of the debrief of assignment one. Remember, the thing you have to do as red teamer, first focus on what lines of defense could there be that you will come across while entering, logically entering the network before you can get your hands on, virtual hands on the gold. What possible lines of defense will be there? Every line of defense will have one or more vulnerabilities. Try to find out that specific line of defense has commonly known vulnerabilities. Check and think, is that vulnerability there or might the blue team have patched that vulnerability? Do you have an alternative when you come across a patched vulnerability? Okay. Then you have to think about, here are several lines of defense with probable vulnerabilities. What tools are there available to pass through the line of defense? Remember, it's Windows based. Remember, there are a lot of open source tools available for hacking. So you can also use those tools for ethical hacking. Search for them, find for them. You don't have to know the ins and outs of a specific tool, but you have to state in your final plan, this line of defense is there. I'm going to attack that line of defense with tool. Because, I don't know, you have to motivate argumentation of why you pick a certain tool first to get in, then to pass by or to overcome the line of defense or to exploit a vulnerability. And finally, when you are through all the lines of defense, making use of the existing vulnerabilities, then you have your piece of gold What tool are you going to use to get it out? You have to make a copy. That's the nicest thing about data, electronically stored information. You can simply make a copy. When it's real gold, you have to go in, grab the gold, and take the gold with you. So the gold is no longer there. But the file you are copying is still there. So it won't be missed, because it's still in place. The only thing you did, you made a copy. And remember, you have a blue team as opponent. The odd number teams are the blue teams. They are defending. So they have to think about, here we have our nice piece of gold, our piece of sensitive proprietary information. What lines of defense are we as blue team building around our piece of gold? Think from outside onwards to the gold. What are we putting in? Per line of defense, as much as possible. Small example. Your outer line of defense is, of course, at the boundaries of your network. You can imagine that as blue team you put a firewall in place. Okay, that's nice, but what type of firewall? Is it packet-based? Is it otherwise based? How are you configuring your firewall? Then think about the settings. They are always delivered and configured with the standard, with the default settings. What are you going to change as blue team on each element of your line of defense so that it can hold out the red teamers? You can get everything you want to. You don't have to look into what it will cost. Make the most appropriate lines of defense using the most common elements to build up a line of defense, and make sure that you configure it right. If you put up a line of defense, blue team, for example the firewall, then be aware that each element of a line of defense, like a firewall, will have standard vulnerabilities. Try to find out if there are tools or whatever available which you can put into place to plug that hole, to diminish that vulnerability. So now it's a real battle, assignment two. The red teamers are trying to work their way through all the lines of defense, and the blue teams have put up several lines of defense, and hopefully they will meet each other somewhere between the lines of defense, and the blue teamers will make the red teamers impossible to get hold of the gold. And blue teamers, if you're smart, think about surveillance, monitoring everything. Every single activity that should not be done on your system should be monitored and logged. Okay. So, the setup is the same. The red teamers come up with a logical black bag job plan, a Word document, and of course a visualization through PowerPoint. The blue teams come up with a defensive plan, which lines of defense are you going to use, how are you going to use it, and when are you aware that a red teamer is trying to get into, is knocking on your first line, on your second line, on your third line, on your fourth line. So you have a logical defensive plan. Is the assignment number two clear?
How do we know what kind of network we have?
Windows based.
Yeah, but three computers, five servers, whatever. We don't know. We
are existing firewalls, IDS, IPS.
You can. You. It's. If you think about the description of the former assignment, you know it's a company that makes software. You know they have the whole fourth floor. They have a headquarters, and the sales department was in another building. So they have a network connecting headquarters and the office building that you tried to break in last time. So you have a connection between headquarters and office building. Within the office building, you have a lot of offices that where are computers that are connected to the network. And they use Windows as operating system. And you can't assume that there is anything in place. If you are a blue teamer, it's your job for our client to think about everything that you should put in place to make it as secure as possible. So you can assume there is nothing. Yes? Is that clear enough? Okay. So this is the brief. Like you are used, I will, after this lecture, when I have access to the VLO, I will see. Otherwise, I'll do it in the evening. I will upload, of course, this the brief on assignment 2, and I will upload also the lecture slides. Okay. Assignment number 2, red teams. How to perform a logical black bag job. Blue teams, how to defend against such a black bag job. Material, 2 ways. The lecture slides, not only from lecture 2, but you can also use the slides of lecture 1. The brief, and then the activities. Search, find, and use overt sources. So you can't know everything. You have to figure out what lines of defense are there possible. What consists, what each line of defense could consist of. What each element of a line of defense has for as vulnerabilities. Try to find material on it. Think about useful keywords to do your searching on internet. Use a good search engine, not only Google. If you do intelligence work or surveillance work, you don't want anybody, or at least as possible, knowing what you are doing. So if you use Google, you certainly know that everything you do with Google is being registered and is put down in the big data center of the National Security Agency in Utah in America. And what they will do with your data, well, we don't know yet exactly. You could use a search engine like this one, DuckDuckGo.com, that doesn't give your IP address away, so you're not trackable, traceable. What we are doing here is what normally espionage is about. Surveillance, intelligence, what real hackers do. And they use overt sources, but they want to be unknown in what they are looking for. So if you are prepared to use other search engines, please do. After you found your overt, your publicly available sources, you have to make your plan ready in phases. I'll talk you through the phases you have to use, and of course visualize your plan. Now you see you have to do the same as a result, one word document with your team plan and 4 to 6 slides in PowerPoint. Okay, homework. Study the book, read chapter 15 for over 2 weeks, perform assignment number 2, remember a different delivery date, the Friday, the 1st of May, and I have to pinpoint you on the phases. I have to go back some to the brief, yes, the debrief. I will make arrangements with the white team that on upcoming Thursday, if it's not possible to do the presentations today, if the system lets us down, then you'll have to do a presentation on Thursday, and then it will be not only the part of the liaison officer, but he needs help. But first I'll talk you to the debrief, then you have your assignment number 2 complete. Okay, you tried to do this physical black bag job. I saw, quickly peeking into the documents, some nice things. But now, the next assignment, you need to use the official stages or phases that you normally use when doing a real pen test or real ethical hacking. Normally, you have a preparation stage, a conduct stage, and a conclusion stage. Well, I saw in a couple of documents this preparation, then do it, and then afterwards. For assignment number 2, you need to use this. These are the standard stages or phases in ethical hacking. You start with your preparation that consists of 2 stages, the reconnaissance and the scanning. I'll explain what each means in a moment. After your preparation, you do the real job, your conduct, that's gaining access, maintaining access, and covering and clearing tracks. So what you have to do while working on assignment number 2, you have to follow these 5 steps. So in your plan that you are going to deliver on Friday, the 1st of May, I will have to see these 5 steps.
For the red teams, right?
Yes, for the red teams, yes, of course. They are the hacking party to this time. But the blue teams can make use of the mindset and the steps hackers are taking. So, the phases in attacking. In your preparation, the first thing you do is reconnaissance. On French, it's actually surveillance. It's trying to find out through some kind of, well, looking into things, what do you have in front of you? It's a preliminary activity, and what you are going to do as an attacker, as a red teamer, is try to gather information about the target. So you know what the target is. This is this software company. And you need this information before you can launch a real attack. The real attack starts here, with gaining access. There are 2 ways of reconnaissance. of intelligence gathering, the passive and the active way. The passive way is simply sniffing, trying to find out what type of computer you have in front of you that you have to go have going to attack, or what type of network it could be. Active is something more, is not only get a feeling of a clue about the computer, but really probing if it's the network or the computer you think you have in front of you. And with the answers you get back, then you have a picture of what you have to tackle. After you have your general information, based on that, you go one step further, one step deeper, by scanning. Well, reconnaissance is simply let the information come to you. And when you have got that information, then you are actively trying to verify the information you found. And it's simply, well, you can say polling if you think what's there is really there. I don't use specific words because I don't want to give too many clues away. So before you really start to attack, you do the scanning, and then you have enough detailed information about what possible line of defenses there are, so what kind of vulnerabilities there could be, and then you are trying to get all your tools together into your toolbox, and then you're going to conduct the attack. The first thing you have to do is gaining access, logical access. How do you logically break into the network, into the computer? Well, using the vulnerabilities you just scanned in the line or lines of defense. And when you're in, you want to stay in long enough to reach your target. You're after the gold. So you need to be able to stay as long in, logically, in the system to get hold of the gold. And sometimes you have to perform some activities, maybe you have to upload or download or change something in the system to remain your access. Okay. You need to be able to stay long enough in the system to get to the gold, and when you've got the gold, copy that piece of information and then get out. But before you get out, you have to think about how can I clean up the system in a way that there are no tracks left of my logical accessing the system and copying the file. So you have to think about what tools can I use and where could my tracks of gaining access, maintaining access to the system, where could these tracks be? And how can I wipe those tracks? Because the clue is get unseen and unnoticed in, do your job, and get unnoticed and unseen out without being discovered. That's a hell of a job for the red teams, because they have an awful lot of countermeasures that have put the blue teams in place. And now the blue teams know that these are the five phases in attacking. They can anticipate on these five phases by putting up the right lines of defenses that could monitor if a red teamer is trying to get logical access to the system. So that is what I meant with use the phases. I'll go to the last part. Yes. This part outline your detailed plan in phases. So the blue, the red teamers need to use those five phases from reconnaissance until covering and clearing your tracks. And the red, the blue teams need to be aware that the red teamers are going to use those five steps. Maybe it's helpful for you. Questions about assignment number two? Everything clear?
Yes.
Then I'll try. Try again. Okay. We'll solve this problem as follows. It's an event, but it's not a security incident. But it's not nice because you're dependent on the infrastructure. I don't want to waste time, so I will give you the opportunity to talk into into your own team about assignment number two. And I want for upcoming Thursday, 2 o'clock, per team, the liaison officer in 3, 4, 6, plus an extra member of the team that will, if you're selected, will do the presentation of the results of your team. So two members per team, the liaison officer and a presentator. You know already that from the odd numbers, number 9 was selected. So number 9 can count on doing the first presentation on Thursday. The white team will do the procedure on Thursday, and they will guide you through picking two more, well, one more because of the time. There will be picked out of this cup one extra odd number to do a presentation. And here I have the even numbers after the two odd numbers are done. The cup is emptied and the white team members will put in the even numbers in there and they pick out two teams. So we have four teams upcoming Thursday to do the presentation you uploaded. And I'm... Guys! Hey! Remember that if you have questions as a team, hand them over to your liaison officer so that the liaison officer on Thursday can put your questions for your team forwards and get answers. And it's like in real life, that's why I announce them liaison officers when you are doing intelligence work or surveillance work or spy work, you talk about liaison officers. I have to apologize on behalf of the HVA for the not functioning of the network. I'm sorry, we have to deal it another way. It's time for you to wrap up. Talk with your team, make arrangements, and you'll be expected one liaison officer and one presenter upcoming Thursday, 2 o'clock. Even de camera uitzetten, moment.